the Ohio person to Shte's Michigan person. So take that how you will, but don't hold it against me. I'm going to do some poems. This first one is called I Am at Work. I am at work when I am asked to explain poetry. I can explain poems, I claim, but explaining poetry is like explaining trees or living or air. All this to say, it has to feel like breathing. I am at work running a concert of cowboy hats and ketamine when the DJ plays something that sounds like every frequency humans shouldn't hear. It was put into a blender and water hosed out of a wind turbine.
Ow!
These kids, my age mostly, love it. They place uncovered ears directly to the speakers, start fights with brick walls, and never stop dancing. I need this explained to me. On the worst nights, I keep people who are trying to live too hard from dying. Can you hear me? Keep your head up. Remember to breathe. Can you hear me? On the easy nights, I sit in the counting room and listen to the walls vibrating way too loudly. I take the time to write, to read the books I've kept stuffed in my bag all year. I don't know any more about poetry than it does of me. I know it is a silent observer, a ghost in the corner staring me down. Even now, I know it knows my name. I know the rough edges of its reflection and the humming of the walls when it's in the room. When I am not working, I'm keeping people who want to die from dying. I am doing the dishes, paying for laundry or lifts or rent. I am sending pictures of cats or poems and explaining Lady Lazarus. The worst thing about poetry is how quietly it happens. How you must find it in every room it's in. The best thing about poetry is that it is always there. A shattering you can't feel until you press your face to the glass. It is easier to find once the music starts, or after, when your ears stop ringing, when the roads clear up, the ambulance pulls away. Even if I quit writing, my family will still ask for poems, and I will still want to die. I pretend to explain poetry, and they pretend to understand. This way, we only disappoint ourselves. Not all my poems are that sad, but this one is. This next one's called The Filling of a Drying Lake. I bite at my nails, the hardened parts the body. I'm trying to soften myself with teeth, a sanding down of space, every ditch, a river, or canyon, an ocean I could have swam in if I had made it there sooner. Nobody claims to have seen the ghosts of marine life in the Grand Canyon. Surely they would be there, and surely someone would have seen it by now. My sister says she saw a ghost cat in our father's apartment when we were young. She says she named it Smokey. I don't believe in ghosts because it all seems too convenient. Like he can die and be dead and not be alive and still be here at the same time. I don't remember what life was like before I was born, so why would I be forced to remember anything after? The only furniture in my room is my father's leather armchair, clawed almost to shreds. Once a friend told me they used the Ouija board to speak with the ghost in their house. But the only one that answered was my father, and they never really spoke to me again. Life is strangled by arbitrary rules that make the idea of breathing feel like a cheat code. Ghosts aren't real because if they were, my father would have apologized by now. God isn't real because if they were, they would have apologized by now. Manifesting isn't real because if it were, it means I killed my father. If ghosts were real, I would have seen one by now. Still, like the sun, I search for the ghosts I'll never find. I pull water with a stick from the river and wait for my nails to grow back. So as usual, there are poems that take energy out and there are poems that give energy and put energy into the room, and those ones are pretty fucking sad, so this is my attempt to make that better. This is called Notes on Diving. Stand at the edge of an abyss and stay there. Don't think of the possible depths, the furious tide. Remember how your mother bathed you in the kitchen sink. Want for nothing but a cradle, a warm body to hold your head to. Stop thinking of the dishes that will steep beside you. Hold your arms above your head and never put them down. Shame is just another word, and there's no language underwater. Let your body speak for you. One hand eclipsing the other, let yourself hover and never fold your fingers. Nothing holds worth in the water. Place one foot in front of the other and pray to a world where you could sit comfortably in a sink, where there was no dirt but the dishes, no God but the faucet, and die when it hits you. The water isn't warm and the sea tastes nothing of soap. You will want to leave again. Know first that no other world within reach will take you. No arms stretched open that hold so gently still. Open your eyes. Stare into the abyss until it swallows you and deny it. Breathe out. Bubbles, less soapy or just as brief. Let yourself drown for a moment. Remember a world of oxygen and mothers. Remember how to cover yourself in mud, how the wet earth covered your skin like a blanket, and how quickly you'd run inside once the rain stopped. Thank you.